Greetings. Thanks for being here. I feel particularly excited and inspired to be here with you guys tonight. This is a topic near and dear to my heart, and I believe to Johnny's as well. We were speaking yesterday and just saying that we feel so remarkably blessed that we live in a time in which these models are available to help us understand what's going on in our spiritual journey. And literally never before in history has there been such a comprehensive understanding of how to navigate the spiritual experience. And it's a big topic. And it's an important topic, an especially important topic in this community because we have so many psychonauts and explorers and cartographers and people committed to their own inner and outer journey. So I feel excited to share, you know, a bit of what I have learned and to be sharing space with Johnny, who just in my eyes is masterful at sharing and experiencing and creating states for others. So
just want to say one thing to really get that conceptually, like imagine you're born in a village in China and then all of a sudden you start to have some experiences and you ask around and then there's one person that's known of and you have to travel 200 miles, right? Or that you're in the Middle East and then like it's fundamentalist Islamic, but then there's one Sufi kind of order that's like secret. And then that's all the awareness that you would have, that lineage that's been learning for hundreds and thousands or hundreds of years or thousands of years, like that particular technology. So we didn't have the internet. You didn't have like, oh, do I want to go to a yoga or a Qigong class today? Oh, do I want to do mushrooms or ayahuasca? Like you didn't like really they were that blessed. Right, and so consciousness is evolving much more quickly, and the maps can really be helpful. So that's kind of what tonight is about.
One of the other things that I love about this topic is that we get to start to implement a hierarchical system and a hierarchical model for the way that we experience spiritual states. And I just want to speak into that for a moment because a lot of people on the spiritual journey, they see hierarchy and they say, wait a second, did we get rid of hierarchy with all this spirituality stuff?
No, that was green.
Yeah, exactly. And the hierarchy is not meant to create a better than, worse than. It's meant to be a natural descriptor of different experiences. And as we can start to put those descriptors in place so you can understand where you're living in a map of reality, it's not a control, it's a tremendous freedom. Because you can say, oh, I'm here, and look at this vast landscape of what else is available. Oh my goodness, I thought this was the whole thing. Or I was here and I had no idea where I was, but now that I see all these other contexts, I have a much deeper, a much greater understanding of where I am and what else might be available. So there's just a amazing freedom in starting to understand these states and then looking at them from a couple different perspectives, cross-culturally and cross-contextually.
I'll just give a personal story on that. After like I think maybe 8 years of daily meditation, I took like the tradition that I study is Tibetan Mahamudra, and basically the Tibetans would sit in caves and they would do a meditation and then they would describe their states. So they sit for 30 minutes and then they talk about like, oh hey, what was your state like? And so then I was just getting to relaxation. Well, just doing one little thing to brighten, all of a sudden then okay, this took it to a whole. It's like I went into a whole. There's a whole other room. And then another, and then do this, and then another one, and another one, another, da, 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 da. And so that's kind of, again, like the example of the map can and the pointing out instructions of, hey, when this is there, notice and check this, like, can really dramatically change our reality.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things that we talked about that we would love to infuse tonight with is a little bit of fun and humor, because I mean, why not, really? I mean, because we can be dry and didactic and, you know, like super scholarly, but who cares? You know, let's make it applicable. And for all the spirituality, and I'll put that in quotes pretty much all night, and I'll explain why at the end, but for all the spirituality that happens in Encinitas, let's, you know, just take it easy. And I love to poke fun at myself and to take myself easily, so there's going to be a little theme of that kind of running through the evening.
Yeah. And I think part of this is sometimes concepts or clothing or words are a replacement for our, like, our states. Yeah. So
yeah.
Then you can be relaxed and like wear, say whatever you want to an extent, like, right? But like it's really the transmission.
Totally. And also just a note on the title, pretty much just expert level hubris to say spirit hacking, right? But we kind of decided that, you know, given all the talks that happened in Encinitas, all the other titles had pretty much been taken, and we thought this one might pique some interest. So, you know, and the way that you talked about hacking yesterday was awesome. So if you'd like to.
Yeah, I think that. You know, originally it came from computer hackers finding loopholes, shortcuts, but it's now become kind of best practices that hacking, you know, neurohacker collective or consciousness hacking, life hacking. So we kind of came at that from that slant. But we want to really, like, and as much as we're kind of breaking down states and kind of best practices, like, we also want to hold the mystery of the divine and the love and the devotional piece that's unnameable. And so we're not, there's a tremendous humility in like true spirituality. So let us not try to think we're, you know, cocky hackers.
Yeah. Totally. So we recognize that there's many familiar faces and some unfamiliar faces. So given that we're going to be spending a little bit of time together, we just wanted to take a couple minutes and create some intro so you get some context on who we are. And I think that just makes a little bit more of an easy flow. So Johnny, you want to share a little bit of your background?
Sure. And then we're going to do some experiential stuff
because
We don't want it to be all mental. Coach, group facilitator, been doing men's groups for about 7 years. Come from master's in psychology, deep practice for many years, personal life, and come from a developmental perspective. So I think you're going to feel that flavor that really helping to track the maps of that, of human potential and human development. And my work is around presence and connection. This is my particular fascination. So. Honored to be here.
Yeah, and Johnny has a new book out on presence, which I'm sure he'll mention to you later, and he doesn't know that I'm just planting the seed that all of you should have that book on your bookshelf, if not in the very near future, then in the intermediately near future. So my background is in healing and personal transformation. I'm historically a chiropractor, do a technique called network spinal analysis that's pretty much at the crossroads of healing and personal development, and if there was a third axis, it would probably be magic. So that's kind of my background. My design or my intent in coaching is helping people bridge the gap between where they are and where their soul demands that they must be. So I find myself really watching some of these spiritual states that we're talking about being a primary driver for the development that's happening for a human being, both in their healing process, but also in their business process, in their relationship process, and everything else that's going on in their life. So that's why this topic really was exciting for me. And I also just want to say, you know, I teach a lot, Johnny teaches a lot. The reason we got excited to do this together is a mutual love of the content. The reason that I got excited to present with Johnny is he's one of the few people I know who I've watched drop into an intentional holding of a state, and I was like, this guy, holy cow. Like, he's got the goods, and I've been around a lot of people who do the work, so just really grateful to be sharing space and time and you know, just energy with you tonight.
Yeah, man, me too.
So do a little basic states framework.
And do you want to pass that out, or do you want to?
It's all out.
Okay. Yeah.
So
we're always in a state.
What's that?
Like we're always in a state, that framework?
No, just the going through some of the gross subtle, just that basic idea.
Let's do this.
Do a movement, great.
Let's go experiential, all right? In your own consciousness, like how do you distinguish where your attention goes? So you might think of awareness as the space we find ourselves in. And then part of what we're gonna do, and you saw in the diagram, is kind of like greater vantages. You guys know Russian nesting dolls? Remember that, like when your kid's like the small one goes in da-da-da-da-da? So think of awareness as like these containers of awareness that we can have greater and greater kind of vantages of experience. So in the smallest one, we're kind of contracted into our own, like our own body. But some of us can be dissociated and kind of not even in there. So this is a couple of starting points. So you might first start by expanding your awareness, like outwards. And you just notice how this affects your breath and body. Do you feel more kind of relaxed and resourced when you do this? And then let's come back in and then go all the way in deep, really rooting into the ground, bending your knees and your feet, really like if you were a tree and you had roots sinking deep into the earth. And then you want to just check, does that have you feel more kind of relaxed and resourced? So by expanding or by going deep into it, do you want to come into anything in this moment? Okay, so the first vantage is the body, physical body or gross body. Now here's the thing, the more that we can feel, it's kind of like the Panama Canal, when one part gets full, then it has extra resource and energy to go into the next one. And when that fills up, then it has extra energy and resource to go into the next one. Does that make sense? So the more that we can kind of inhabit our bodies and feel our bodies and feel more resourced, then this gets us access to the second one, which is subtle. But first we'll start by just really scanning the physical body. Start with your feet. And I want you to, we're just gonna take a couple minutes here. I want you to notice if there's any dead zones, numbness, aliveness, and pain, or pain, or bliss, or pleasure. Just start with your feet and slowly scan up. And if your attention wanders, see if you can just bring it back.
As you're doing that, I'll add a awesome complicating factor. If you are a highly energetic being, I'll invite you to see if you can notice your physical body without the attention on all that energy. See if you can notice the body more in isolation.
Oh, nice. Moving up the rest of the legs. Yeah, so see if you can turn down the energy and just feel like the skin and the bone and the muscles. Moving up the pelvis. And as you move over your sexual organs, notice what you feel. Can you feel anything there? Is it alive and pulsing, pleasurable, or does it feel more numb, closed? And then continue up the belly. So now we start to get into the area where there tends to be more emotion. And how's your breath? Moving up to the heart. How's as your throat. Face, jaw. See if you can actually feel the bones of your jaw. See if you can feel the muscle of your tongue. So before we move on to the next vantage, just take 10 seconds or so and notice what happened when you brought more attention to your physical body, if your mind got more quiet. The latest research on mindfulness indicates that mindfulness starts in the body. So the more that we can feel and the more alive that it is, the quieter the mental activity tends to be. Okay, so now we're going to go to the second vantage. And again, once there's more aliveness in the physical, then we can get more subtle awareness. So who feels, if you do this, who feels an aliveness in between? Who feels, if you've ever had acupuncture, who can notice if you can feel meridians or even aliveness through your hands, all throughout your body? So see if you can, if you want to point out anything about subtle.
That's great. Yeah, notice close to the body and see what happens if you bring your awareness out just a little bit, maybe 6 inches, maybe 10 inches. Is there a sense of heightened attention or potency around the body? When you bring your awareness back in, do you feel a little bit closer to the body? As you're noticing that energy in all different areas, do you also notice that there may be access to even more emotion?
So subtle energy, chi in the meridians, your subtle body or your aura, orgasm, rapport in connection, emotion, these are all subtle aspects of life, right? So if somebody doesn't feel emotion or they have trouble with rapport, then they're just at the level of physical. There's not subtle online in their system as much yet. So before we leave subtle, let's see if we can feel your central channel and see if you can increase that you feel your chakras and your kundalini energy. See if you can allow this to turn up a little bit. Uh-huh. So remember, when we have more energy-rich states, this gives us access to even higher vantages. Maybe spread out a little bit, give yourself some space.
Good, and as you notice your own personal system light up and fill with energy, see if you also notice a potentizing of the space. Do you get a sense of the space being thicker, more dense, more full, more rich? Is it easier to feel yourself with that energy around you? little bits of movement of your body help you to feel that energy move. You're welcome to do that. That's it.
Anybody feeling more heat? Anybody feeling a little bliss? Okay. So all that's subtle vantage, right? Now what's important about the vantages is the research is they tend to stabilize progressively. So I don't want to get too mental here. Stay in the experience. I'll talk more about that later. But just know stabilization, that you start to feel these at all times, is important. So you might tag this so that as you leave, then you're standing in line and you can put your, at the grocery store, and then you can put your attention on subtle energy. You can put your attention on your breath. You can start to amplify this. When you're making love, you can start practicing with the internal energies. You can, when you're walking, you can see, can I feel qi? Right? So that more and more that your system feels this stabilized. Does that make sense? Okay, let's move to the third vantage. So now see if you can feel outwards. Maybe you feel towards the ocean. Start feeling towards the wall. Start feeling towards this wall. So keep tethered, keep your attention tethered in your ground, but then just feel like a sense of spaciousness out there. And then go beyond, see if you can feel the, like, towards the ocean. And then for those of these, this is available, can you feel the boundary? Still tethered in the central axis. Now feel outwards in all directions. And see if you can feel a sense of ever-present stillness underneath. So as bodies are moving, or there's sounds or movement, colors, see if underneath you can feel this infinite span of stillness.
In that stillness, see if you can notice the space, the relation between the space and you, while holding that wide span. See if you can notice the space between the space.
Now see if you can feel, now come, like, see if this can open such that there's just open awareness. And then direct your attention into your body and see if you can find your sense of self. Like, where's the you? Is this solid? Or is it transient flickers of sensation, emotion, thoughts. Search in the mind. Search in the body. And see if you can allow the sense of self to relax. Sense of self empty. Time. Sense of timelessness. Time too empty.
As you notice that relationship to the emptiness of time, see if there's any sense of the you that has always existed.
The big you.
Even before time existed.
Notice the camera, the observer that's ever present, that's always been observing. Ever present witness. Fourth vantage. If you need to sit down, go ahead. You're doing it right, exactly as you are. Your nervous system is exactly where it needs to be. And you might also notice a seamlessness. Seamless unity, like a sea, a vast sea of love or flow. Everything connected. Everything part of this one timeless moment. And then if it's available, even the observer is empty, subject, object. Merge. Pure suchness. Fifth vantage. So, hold the largest vantage of awareness possible. And then let's trace back from the beginning. So even in vast open awareness, there's still skin and bones in a body. If you can feel the feet on the ground and the bones in your lower legs. And then remember, second one is subtle energy, breath, emotion, energy, meridians, several inches off the body, the field surrounding. And then the third one, you might feel like immense openness or spaciousness, or that you can feel infinity, or you feel an infinite stillness underneath. This may be the edge for your nervous system right now, and that's okay. Fourth, ever-present witness. Like a camera, always watching. Fifth is beyond words, beyond names. Although some refer to it as non-dual.
And notice, can you transit between those states easily? Where do you feel the most comfortable? Where might you be in the bulk of your day? Where are you really being called to be? Where does your life need you to be more of the time?
If you feel subtle energy sporadically throughout your day, how could you make a fun little reminder to gradually and in a fun way just start to train your system that you start to feel energy more and more? Or if that's stable for you, if you feel energy pretty much all the time, and then you have glimpses of this vast openness or spaciousness, how could you just practice feeling spaciousness more and more, more and more, till that too becomes the stable base, that you're walking around that as a body in infinity. You're talking, you're working on your computer, you're exercising, but you still feel infinity. So we're gonna have us, and also, like, there's not so much efforting in the higher vantages, but we also don't have to be serious. Like, we can, there's a deep relaxation to it. So let's split up into triads. So find a group of three. And then we're gonna talk about how that was for you. So one person at a time, how that was for you. And then how you, like, what kind of a little mini practice you can make around that, okay? So let's pair up into threes, please. Practice what we just did while you're listening. So you're practicing how much awareness can you inhabit while the other person's talking. Number two, you're the listener. And number one, you're the speaker, right? So number two, how open can your heart be when you're listening? These are our little practices. Okay, go ahead. Let's take a minute or so.
To come back. So person number three, just watch as your mind engages in the story. Are you able to continue to hold that wide vantage? Just watch that interplay between your conscious attention and the mind wanting to assert its natural role.
Okay, let's go ahead and rotate. Now number two is going to be the speaker. Number three is going to be the listener. And if you were just the speaker, number one, now you open as awareness to the extent that you can. Okay, another minute or so, number two. Okay, number three, listener, did they raise your hand if they named a practice? Cool. Okay, last rotation. If you were just speaking, now your awareness.
So first a little construct and framework. So the states again are gross, subtle, causal, witness, and non-dual. And each of these states have corresponding, the first three anyway, have corresponding brainwave patterns and experiences that we have that we can relate to. So gross is conscious awareness. Our experience right now of being awake is a gross awareness. A subtle awareness is experienced in dreaming. So all of that content in dreams that's kind of thematic and emotional and doesn't really always make linear logical sense, all of that is subtle. That's happening as a state in the brain that is accessing the subtle body, the subtle realm. We also experience subtle realms and subtle states when we have things like religious visions. So you see Saint Jerome on the mountainside, that's a subtle body state experience. Causal body is associated with deep dreamless sleep. So that place that your consciousness goes to after the dream, where it's just pure, open spaciousness, where there's the void, yeah, the nothingness. That's associated with the causal body and merging into witness.
Makes sense. So we experience, our brain experiences these actually every 24-hour period. But it's about awakening, which we're going to talk about later, is stabilizing these moment to moment.
So what it felt exciting to talk about in this is just recognizing what might be in a subtle state experience. And
before we do that,
yeah,
could we do the Houston Smith?
Totally.
So I think this is just kind of completes nicely the last experiential exercise. If you look at your handouts, the one where there's kind of the comparative graphs, this one here. So fascinatingly, all of these different wisdom traditions, Christianity, Islam, Tibetan Vajrayana Buddhism, Hindu Vedanta, they recognized independently in their own kind of practice dojos, caves, and ashrams, that there were these same grooves of vantages in human consciousness. They called them different names, right? Now, the ones that the names that we're referring to, the Hindu Vedanta and the Tibetan Vajrayana Buddhism, gross, subtle, causal, then the Tibetans called it very subtle, but basically the same thing. Then you get into witness and non-dual. So that this is, again, these are These are kind of like structures in the human hardware system, the human spiritual hardware system. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. And one of the things that I love about that is this indicates it's not something that we're making up because we want to hold a class, right? You know, this has kind of been figured out for thousands and thousands of years. And the other aspect of that that I love is that when we start to talk about spiritual states, a huge population, a segment of the population just kind of goes, bang, right? They just kind of shut down. Right. But if we say, hey, like, this isn't like a frou-frou thing, we're not imagining this, this is a technology of human awareness that's been recognized over and over and over and over again, and it's not just because the hippies figured it out in the 60s, so now it's a thing. So, as we're looking at these states, one of the most common that I've seen since I've arrived in the Southern California area is many, many people having subtle body state experiences. And these subtle body state experiences can look many different ways, and there's many different kind of flavors in which they can arise. But anything that you see that has really thematic elements, but has a lot of content, has a lot of story, has a lot of mythos, any of those types of things are subtle body state experiences. So you take ayahuasca and you learn about the spirit of Mother Aya, incredibly profound subtle body state experience. You go to the meditation gardens and Yogananda appears to you and gives you your mission in life. Amazing spiritual subtle body state experience. And the reason that I share this is that there seems to be, and this is where I get to be an Encinitan poking fun at the other Encinitans, including myself, there's often this kind of grandiose observation of these as the most ultimate experience. There's a high pedestal on which these experiences seem to live. And they're amazing experiences and really important. And when you have them contrasted with a causal body, a witness, or a non-dual experience, now there's a much wider context in which to understand that. So I bring this up not to say that one is better than the other. That's not the point in any way, shape, or form. But just to understand that there are other experiences to be had. And the thing that I find in a subtle body state experience is that it's really easy to wind these stories, these experiences, these journeys, all of these things that happen, to wind them around the ego. And for it to really be an exaltation of us in ever subtle and subtle kind of nuanced ways. And like, I think most of you will agree with me, like, there's something especially deliciously annoying about the spiritual ego. Because it's so delicious and tasteful and it's just about right, but then it's a little glitch, right? And I'm speaking for me, from me. This is me teaching myself as well. So I see that as a context of the powerful crystal, you know, the... Please.
So, I mean, so one thing that we want to, like, the larger the vantage, the more we realize the whole world is inside of us, right? The more awareness of the ego, then we see, like, oh, yeah, I know that part of me, too. It's not like he has it and I don't, right? So, like, that we have intimate awareness that we know this, right? So, that's a... Think back to, like, college when we were, like, you party, you went out, and then the next morning or next day, like, you're talking about how fucked up you got and like, oh my God, do you remember I did this, right? So in a way, we do the same thing, right? Like, oh my God, I did so much mushrooms. Like, I was seeing visions and like, oh my God, my Kundalini fucking awakened. I was just 20 minutes orgasming, right? And that's fun. Like, that's beautiful, totally. And that helps us to metabolize it. And of course, we share this with our most intimate, like, people. But also just notice that part of ourselves And then if we're getting worth points by telling the stories of all the states we have, then like that's where we want to like maybe check that out.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah. So one of the things that I would love to bring up as a pondering point in this is truth. What is true? And as we look at truth existing at each of these levels, is there a truth that becomes more true as you move to the next level? And as you have a subtle, a causal, a non-dual experience, how do you bring that truth back here? And there's been so many people throughout history who have gone down amazing explorations and also infinite fractal rabbit holes of trying to bring the truth of the subtle body and the causal body back to this place, because that's the thing that's going to save us all. So I just offer that as a way to look at the thing that's true in that realm and in that state. Hold it as sacred and as something you fully and deeply believe in one hand, and in the other hand also say, maybe that's true, we'll see, and let reality inform you on if it's really true. And the way that I love to play this is, if you have a subtle state experience that informs you that you're here to be the person that saves the planet, go do that without proclaiming that you're the one that's here to save the planet. You know, so prove it right. And also, you know, just recognize how easy that is to kind of tie into our ego. And I think the magic here is holding both. Mm-hmm. Like, oh my God, this is so potent, so powerful, and so valuable. And maybe, let's prove it right.
Does that make sense? Because the fixation on us, on something, tells us something. Like if we can hold this as a like very likely possibility, and we can be relaxed that maybe not, like there's kind of a spaciousness in this.
The other thing that I wanted to share in this, and we didn't talk about this yesterday, but I know you've got loads of wisdom here, is exogenous versus endogenous inducers of these states. So exogenous means it comes from the outside. Endogenous means it comes from the inside. So what we just did was an endogenously created, we chose in the moment, just based on our pure awareness, to have those state experiences. You can use substances to have exogenous state experiences. What I've often seen is that there is little bit of preface first. So in each state, in the subtle, gross, subtle, and causal, there is considered to be a body. There's obviously a gross physical body. We have a form. There's a subtle body, which we can think of as an energy body or an emotional body. There's a causal body. So when people use a lot of exogenous, a lot of external ways of inducing subtle body state experiences, it's like big blast of energy into the body, and then that energy washes out. All of the research says that the number one way to stabilize these experiences is meditation. That's an endogenously driven way to cultivate these states. Now, this isn't a judgment saying one is better than the other, but really just to say that a really solid meditation practice is going to help stabilize these experiences and really give you access to them at a moment's notice and at your choice. And there's a level of just kind of cultivation that you notice around a person who has a deep and powerful and strong meditation practice. So I just offer that as another juxtaposition for you to play with as you're in this exploration for yourself.
And we'll talk more about that at the end about around practices, but I mean, psychedelics, occasional psychedelic experiences for me have been profound and life-changing.
Yeah.
The way that it seems now, looking back over the last 10 years, it's almost like I, in terms of the subtle, it's like I get a subtle, it's like I get a glimpse of what the future embodied state can be. So what this current baseline is now, like maybe in an experience 5 years ago or a few years ago on mushrooms, then this was what it felt like. And so like there's a real sacredness to like plant medicine, but hold it like that, like it's giving you a glimpse into what's possible to bring back into this moment.
Awesome. Awakening process?
Yeah. So, like, I think from India, so enlightenment has a lot of stigma around it, right? And some people say it like it's a discrete state. And the same thing with awakening, like, oh, I had my awakening on September 12th or something, you know? And it's like, to distinguish gradual versus progressive. So people like Byron Katie or Eckhart Tolle, who at the, you know, basically suicidal, then all of a sudden, some would say that they're, all of a sudden, everything, awareness just opened up and stayed wide open. And their personal self stayed relaxed. So for most people, you guys heard of Adyashanti? So in his, you know, 20 years experience, he says 99% of people, that the spiritual awakening process is a gradual process. Practice helps. So it's kind of like hope to win the lottery and keep practicing. There are certain traditions and practices, Dzogchen, that it's like you constantly remember, like lottery, like point awareness, while you keep practicing. So I just want to say, like, there, like, yes, at any moment you can open, why the fuck open? And like, work, you know, we'll get into this more in practices, but I want to just like really honor the gradual like cultivation path. So to make it more tangible, to make it more like clear for us, let's imagine that the awakening process is that the personal self starts to fade in and out. So somewhere between, this is why we, when you're talking about bringing the experience back and deconstructing it, because somewhere in between causal, like all of a sudden the personal self gets left at the door. Now, at the, if you know spiral dynamics, we have a map back there. Dr. Matt and Andrew Reed did a beautiful workshop. The research is at above integral, the next stage above integral turquoise, which is called construct aware. I don't want to go too much into that now. But that the personal self start as a, that's the stages of ego development. So that's where the personal self starts to fade in and out, like just on a daily, like throughout the day. Now, each of these stages, when a stage starts to come online, it's wobbly. So as you think back into your, maybe after college or in your early 20s, like you had a big life transition, things in your life started to disintegrate, and then when you get into the next stage, it starts to be wobbly. Okay? Now imagine the awakening process like this. As you're stabilizing subtle, like then it becomes, you know, first it's wobbly, like, oh, I have like a glimpse of, I have a really high state and I feel all this energy, or like a drug experience, or like I'm making love and all of a sudden my kundalini opens up and I'm like, you know, having an orgasmic waste. So these start to be tastes, right, that are wobbly, and then it eventually stabilizes. So just like the in the personality or the ego structures, these start to get wobbly, stable, disintegrating, wobbly, stable, disintegrating. So too with these vantages. And the awakening process is where the beginning of it, would we could say, happens in causal or turquoise, when the personal self starts to fade in and out, all the way on up through when non-dual becomes stable, which this is not anywhere close. But just for a context, so you really get the sense that it's like awakening process. Does that make sense, guys? Questions on that?
Basically, if enlightenment is the goal and you've reached it, you probably haven't reached it. Yeah.
So in just subbing that word, and getting the context as a process.
And it's like the because the universe is a naturally unfolding process, there's always a forward march in time and in complexity and in growth. It's the finish line that keeps on moving.
Yeah, that's why we're saying we're demystifying that, and we're saying like this is better to not use that word and more use awakening process. And then when you ask what's this, well, the personal self starting to relax, and so the higher vantages are like operating as awareness. Right, you would probably say it's more stable, non-dual, and then in some traditions there's even beyond that. But in terms of like spiritual practitioners, like that we're really practicing, like in like saying a discrete state of enlightenment, like this makes it's much more useful for our own practice if we understand the awakening process and how to stabilize these vantages. Does that make sense? So don't think a discrete, single state.
And it's easy to do that because the religious traditions have created an avatar that seems to be fixed in this non-dual unity consciousness. Like we think of the Buddha as an enlightened being, and he had non-dual consciousness. And the more static we let that be, the more of a concept we let it be, and the farther we get from it. So that's basically the idea, is how can you let yourself unfold through this process ever more and more so that we are constantly moving towards our highest expression, towards a non-dual state in a stabilized way.
Yeah. And just one thing, like we did a lines of development workshop a couple months ago. And so this is the spiritual line, right? But there's still like our work in showing up in the world, and there's still our emotional intelligence, and there's still our moral impact. So I might be able to like have practiced meditation for a number of years, but if I'm not aware of the impact that I'm having on others, like that interpersonally things are gonna get really messy, and then I'm spinning more karma because I'm unconscious of harming you. So that's why in integrated spiritual practice that we're working like the multiple lines, not just the meditative. However, the theory goes, the greater the vantage we have, the more life force and energy we have to kind of grow up all of the other parts and show up in the world. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it essentially creates the person who may have a causal awareness, but they're a jerk. You know, like who needs that, right? Because as you're looking at these different lines of development, if they have they haven't done so much moral work, bad news, you know, and they may have the stabilized higher consciousness states, and it makes it really confusing.
Yeah.
Especially if they're a teacher. You go and you find this master, and you go and find this person who, you know, really is able to transmit like pure spiritual essence, but they're morally a scumbag. You know, we talked about this, and if any of you were at the Spiral Dynamics class, you know, the yoga teacher who is brilliant and can do all these postures and their language, and then they hit on the women in the class. Like, that's not okay. And you can have that, and it can be confusing, that real mastery of the spiritual state and less of a moral development, as an example, or emotional. Say it again. Totally possible. That you're exactly speaking to the point. So you're helping us clarify what we're saying. So the emotional and the moral and the spiritual and the social and interpersonal, these are all different ways and all different maturations. So they grow at different rates and different speeds. So if someone didn't have a lot of socialization, for an example, they didn't have to learn a lot of morality. They just were sitting in a cave their whole life figuring out spirituality and meditation. They might not have really hardly any moral construct, but they have these amazing, amazing spiritual developments. And the whole reason to point this out is it's been so confusing, especially in the West, for so long.
So the first thing that I would say is the ability to self-reflect comes on as an adult at the orange level of consciousness. This is why at the fundamentalist level that we have to kind of supplant our beliefs and how to live in the world out to institutions, maybe religion, because they don't have the ability to self-reflect. So that's kind of self-reflection inside. The other thing we want to say is like you probably felt yourself stretched tonight at some point, right? There was probably some point at which your energetic or nervous system like didn't go beyond. And so that's normal. Everybody has, we all have our edges. So sometimes it's useful to understand a concept or understand what the next room is like, because it can help us get there. The one thing that I would say is, although we can occasionally jump way ahead, it's the reason that we demonstrated it in a progressive way is because we talked about the more energy rich you have, then that stabilizes, then you get to the stabilized subtle. So we can tell you what that is and just know that it's useful to really stabilize these things. So remember where you felt your edge was and just keep practicing that in your daily life until that becomes more stable, and then so on and so forth. To answer your question though, the ever-present witness, like imagine this is kind of a camera that's, I want to say like a little above the head.
I experience it less spatially than that, I guess, but
don't get attached to it being spatially and like draw a picture of it, but like let's imagine there's a camera or an observer or a witness around here. Hold that lightly.
Yeah. In my experience of how I most easily slip into that state is, and it's so crazy to talk about this because like all language breaks down. It's a mess.
Yeah.
My experience of how I slip into that is I notice time and I just back out of time. So there's a felt sense of what that's like for me. And then there's a much thinner kind of membrane between me and what is everything else. It's really just like Johnny's saying, just observation of a blanket of reality.
So to get there though, I just want to say, we went through the emptiness of the sense of self and the emptiness of space, so space is infinite, and the emptiness of time. So those are the prerequisites to experiencing ever-present witness. So a lot of times the personal self will be my sense of I, like this will be the operating function. And so if that's there, then by the nature, you're not gonna feel the witness. So there, if you want, like I would recommend for this, one of the quickest things for this is the big mind process. So if you look up big mind, that will help run you through a thing of kind of like unhooking and relaxing this so that the witness, because the witness is there all the time, but when the personal self is operating, it's kind of like just collapses. Is that clear? Okay. Keep going.
I'll also say too, like one of the interesting things about this practice is that reality reveals itself to you as soon as you're ready. So I know, like, and many of you, and I'm sure you, Johnny, have probably had this experience. I read, when I was in my early 20s, I read the Diamond Sutra for like 6 months. It didn't make any freaking sense. But I got some sort of transmission, and I kept on going. There was something that shifted in me, and I kept going. And I've gone back to it in the past few months. And having these new frameworks and models, I was like, oh, I get it. I get it. Reward body is causal body. Oh, my, this thing. Oh, okay. And probably if I go back in another 10 years, I'm gonna be like, you dummy, how did come you didn't get it 10 years ago, you know? So there's this process that reality unfolds itself to you as you go. And I think...
One point on...
please, yeah.
One point on that is, so it is used, sometimes we cognitively understand it first. Yeah. So Matt was even describing an example where he didn't even, what the fuck is that?
Yeah.
He didn't even cognitively get it. And then he started to cognitively get it, and then we embody it. So going to workshops like this, listening to spiritual teachers, reading books, like that helps to give our mind the fodder for what it feels like. But remember at the end of the day that like the experiential stuff, a felt experience is what we're going for.
Yeah. Yeah. And one of the themes that Johnny's already mentioned that's so, so valuable is not necessarily looking ahead to what's coming next, but really stabilizing where you are. So if you do gross really well, awesome. Fill the gross. And if you do like a movement practice, all of a sudden you're going to notice the energy around you. Oh, they're subtle. Now really work with that subtle, stabilize the subtle. All of a sudden you're going to notice that there's like this huge spaciousness. And the more you really fill those with energy, the more that the next level just seems to appear often on its own. And yes, I agree that we sometimes want to look ahead so we can see what's coming up, so we can observe it as it happens, but filling that level is what allows the next level to really kind of come on board.
Is it pleasant or unpleasant?
It's neither. It's just
have you ever worked with Dr. Matt?
Oh, no.
Amazing. I suggest that you have a session because I think he could really take a look at your nervous system and then help you. One thing that I want to say is the more resourced we are at the foundation, then the more that the greater vantage, we can experience the greater vantages. So when there's a lot of, when we have instability, like in our nervous system, it kind of, that's where it uses our primary resources and attention. So this is a master here.
Thank you. And I'll also say that my experience, whether we're looking at spiritual states or not, any maturation process, the universe seems to dole out the next level of what you have to stretch into. So as we continue to grow, there's going to be survival that comes up, and we get to experience who we are in that and love that process and come face to face with the fear and the discomfort, and so we can grow into the next level of evolution. And then when we stabilize that, we get to go through those processes in all these different lines of development and all these fractal vectors, and life just kind of is doing its thing. So being in survival is not a bad thing. It's an amazing thing. And we want to have resources for how we expertly be in survival so we can transition through that state as rapidly as possible, if that's the call.
Thank you. I think this is going to be the essence of the practice design, where we're at time. That's a great question. Let's, if we can say this last. Any one or two last questions? Yeah. Ma'am in the back, yeah. Yeah. I mean, they're arbitrary. Like, God doesn't say there's five antages, but the mind just makes some of these distinctions, but they happen to be similar across cultures. But those two cultures didn't have a fourth. Yeah. Yeah, and really, like, witness, like, it's just kind of a last little vestige before non-dual, so sometimes those could be close.
Yeah. Basically, the colors are what they call memes. They use those instead of giving them numbers, because when you start to put people in numbered categories, people freak out. So spiral dynamics is an amazing developmental model that helps to look at how values and consciousness evolves as a person grows and as cultures and societies grow. So I guess the best reference that I like sharing for that is Integral Meditation.
Ken's book?
Yeah. So a book called Integral Meditation uses that as a framework and looks at a bunch of other stuff that's super valuable. It's a at least 2-hour class unto itself. So,
yeah. What was your question specifically? Is that your question? Yeah. Your ability to take perspectives, your worldview increases at each stage.
The one on the end.
Last one.
That's the work. that's the whole deal. And the more you climb, the more you're going to start to recognize the flavor of the mind until you get to the next level. And there will be a point where the mind just drops away. But that subtle like thinking is, it's just to be met on the meditation cushion over and over and over. If you can stabilize a state in which the mind is no longer running the show, then yeah. So if you can stabilize a witness consciousness.
Yeah, in between causal and witness, then the mental identification kind of relaxes.
And it doesn't mean that you can't ever like have a conversation or ask a question. It just means that in between stimulation, all the mental chatter, all the story, all that kind of self-identification of who you are as a person, just kind of.
Yeah, like a long pause in the conversation, then it can just. But remember, what we did at the end is we had to go back and trace all of them. We're not trying to say like, oh, everything goes away. No, everything, like the whole system is built upon like the Russian nesting dolls. But the greater the vantage, then the more you have access to like kind of all of those underneath you, so that you actually get, like you can use the mind in a much more skillful, like, and beautiful way, instead of it using you or, like, abusing you. What's that?
Are you suggesting you can choose your state then, depending on what?
To an extent, yes, but then at the higher than there, like you talked about, there's the surrender that like life chooses, like life starts using you. But yes, there is more volitional control over attention at least. Yeah, I think to your question, like that's one of the initial benefits of meditation is training your attention to stay. So it like doesn't get so diverted in thoughts and all this, training your attention to stay. And then the second half of meditation is opening as awareness. So Lauren, let's move into like practice design. So how do we integrate this into our life? So this isn't just theory. So the first, take a moment and internally like reflect, like what if somebody asks you the question, what's your spiritual practice? Like what comes to mind? You don't have to say this out loud, but I just want you to do a little reconnaissance work. Like what's your spiritual practice? How do you more and more feel connected to something greater than yourself? What is your act of devotion to God, to life? Like, how do you more and more open as love? How do you love more and more deeply? And then what do you do on a daily basis? Is your work aligned as an offering of love and an offering of service to humanity? And when you wake up in the morning, do you attune your system? Do you attune your body, mind, nervous system such that you can be the greatest instrument of service and love? So that as we talk about practices, that we have the foundation that our practices are sourced from that. Not to necessarily be better. That true spiritual development is in service of all of us. That when you wake up in the morning, like, this is the first thought that you go to check Facebook on your phone, or do you think of God? You think of life all around you. And if not, how can we more and more? So instead of thinking of meditation as this chore, and like, I know I'm supposed to do it, but I don't, but my mind's so busy. And God is asking, what if God asked you to train yourself so that you can feel life? So that you can be the embodiment of your greatest self in service.
When I offer classes, one of my favorite frames for the whole class is usefulness. Usefulness. Yeah. When I teach a class, one of my favorite frames is usefulness. So if we pull this out of the conceptual, if we pull this off the page and into your life, what might happen tomorrow morning after, as Johnny suggested, you wake up and thank God for your first breath? What might happen that would be useful of these things that we've learned tonight that would cause an even greater change for you, for those around you, and potentially humanity at large?
Breath practice, your yoga practice, your meditation practice, getting into nature, reading spiritual texts that have a transmission, making love. Like, these are all ways in the morning that you can open your system. And you can be more in your body and open your channels. So answer your question in a really practical way, like what practice do you do in the morning to open your system? One. And then two, how do you stabilize this all throughout your day? So remember we said, find out where your baseline vantage was. Is it gross and I need to really work on feeling my body more? Or is it subtle and I have some subtle awareness, but then it goes out. So I work on stabilizing that I feel subtle energy at all times. So that if that's your practice, or like you might focus on love, right? Like, you know, that I feel like at all. So you can make a practice that you just focus on, like just all throughout your day, in the grocery store, in line, while you're driving, while you're eating, while you're in conversation, you're focusing on your heart, right? Or you're focusing on grounding. So that's a way to kind of make a practice like that.
How would you say,
I'll say that the more spiritual work, the more state work you do, the more awareness it's going to create of these lower level kind of shadows that need to be addressed. So if there's wounding, if there's trauma, if there's sickness, disease, illness, you know, pain, the more we climb, the entire beingness seeks to stabilize at that level. And if we've got a bedrock of things that need to get looked at, and we try to go here, it's going to make that stuff come alive. So what I see often in the office is people who have blown themselves out in a spiritual experience. Now they have all this awareness, and their life is a mess. Because it's just brought up all this shadow to get looked at, and they're confused on many different things, but really, like, why they're a spiritual being and in love and compassion, but then they've got all this rage, you know, or any other state, the sadness, this depression, because there's all of this that needs to come back into wholeness. And I often see people ping pong, and or they just go into sickness, into disease, you know, whatever may be happening. But essentially, if there's stuff hanging out in the body that's been unloved, unacknowledged, unlooked at, or intentionally bypassed, time for some cleanup.
Most profound state ever. Broke, two jobs in grad school, and felt like shit on that day. And all of a sudden, just grace hit. So we don't want to make a belief that everything in my life has to be perfect for grace to hit. Like Matt said, like loving the state we're in. That said, I think it's really useful to direct our energy to really stabilizing our foundation, like our living situation, our job, our money, like really doing the emotional trauma work in our body, because that uses a lot of the attention and energy that could be used for higher awareness on an average day. Of course, any day grace can hit, but I think to your question, like, let's do both.
Yeah, I love that.
Growing up and waking up.
Love that.
So let's say that we're in witness or higher, and then the mind relaxes and there's not necessarily the experience of the mind. Or everything gets seamless and then the body kind of feels blurred, like the body's not so fixed and solid, it's blurry. That doesn't mean it dissolved, that doesn't mean it went away permanently, right? So the more and more that we're able to utilize, like be skillful in relating in the human domain, at work, in our relationship, while stabilizing the higher awareness, this is kind of the way to focus on. And yes, like all of a sudden, if you've ever been in a state of deep intimacy with somebody and like all of a sudden the colors start to change in their face, shows, like, yes, this is destabilizing in our, and like our brain and mind is kind of like all co-participating in this experience. And let us let us remember that it, maybe it's not as fixed as it sometimes feels at the gross level. But that doesn't mean, like, so we got to be careful. We say, oh, it's all an illusion, and then I'm like really harming somebody or being a dick, right? Like, no, that hurt their heart. So if I can't simultaneously feel awareness and then maybe even feel a little guilt and shame that, like, I said that, that did not hurt their heart. Like, I'm not expanded as awareness if I can't feel you. Like, if I'm in my own state, like, that's not expanded, right? Like, all of us are in awareness, in the container of awareness.
And I'll add, too, that as people have experiences, there's a lot of, like, this, right? And the initial experience that many people have is this or that. And the more work we do, the more possibility we have it be this. So the most ideal situation, and Ken Wilber and many other people talk about this, is that we transcend our level and we include. If we go up to a witness state and we deny the body, then when we come back to the body, we feel like we've lost the witness state. But if the witness state is including the causal, subtle, and gross, we come back to the body, and there's still this essence. There's still this thing that's happening, and we don't have to forsake one or the other. And these big blast-off experiences that people have create oftentimes the this or that that is important as a part of the process. And as we stabilize the entire experience more and more, we just get, for, you know, lack of a better term, the oneness of the whole process simultaneously. Beautiful. Here, you had your hand up. Yeah. No, I think I get the sense of what you mean. So, it's a usefulness question to me. Like, if you're in, say, causal or witness, and you're having a hard time also keeping awareness here, and you're driving your car, maybe let's not do that. If it seems important for you to train yourself so that you can, in the course of a breath, go from gross to subtle to causal to witness, you can do that. That's cool training. Ultimately, you know, what level do you want to stabilize in order to have the most optimal experience of your life in that moment and be, from my perspective, in the most service to the most number of people and make the biggest difference for all of those, including you, and all those around you?
Let me answer this in a way. What tends to happen is you will have a state, just a grace will hit, and you'll have a state experience of something, of one of those, and then you'll come back down to your baseline. So that this tends to happen more and more, and all of a sudden your nervous system, you get more flexible. Who relates to this? Right, so what you, in years past, what you experience as an occasional gift, now all of a sudden this is a daily baseline. Okay, now that said, in terms of stabilizing something so you have volitional access, it tends to be easier to feel it when you're still, because you can focus your attention on it. So, like, for example, then maybe whatever, wherever you're at, then you can't feel it and talk. You start talking and it goes away. Or moving is hard. So you just got to keep practicing and training that you feel it while you're talking and while you're moving. And just keep practicing.
Capacity.
Yeah, so the nervous system is the, I mean, potentially literally the most upgradable system that's ever existed in the history of history. So the thing that I see happen with most people is they run into a bandwidth issue. So they have this big spiritual state, they burn themselves out a little bit with all this opening, they've got all this trauma, the healing work that they need to do, and there's a certain amount of capacity, a bandwidth in the nervous system. So we need A, to do some of that cleanup, get some of the emotional, you know, even just physical trauma that's happened out of the body and into a more integrated state. But then there also needs to be a way of experiencing ourself and the energy and the states that is anchored in the nervous system, because the nervous system is literally the gateway between man the spiritual and man the physical. So it's the antenna that's kind of helping us have that spiritual experience in a body before we transcend the body. So I've seen, as people really create more ease, flexibility, power, capability, just kind of integrity in their nervous system, potentially the easier they're going to have access to higher vantages. And partially just because they don't get knocked over so easily. You know, there's just more resourcefulness to experience more.
Let me name three of what I think, like, the categories of the most important practices in light of what we're talking about here. One is meditation, training the attention and opening as awareness. Meditation. Two would be some kind of subtle energy practice. Yoga, Kundalini yoga, Qigong, Tai Chi, certain types of, you know, sexual tantra. Subtle energy practice. Ideally you do breath work as well. Ideally you do these things daily. And then the third would be trauma desensitization. Because I think, like, the numb places or the places we dissociated from the past, like, I think this uses up our energy and attention. And so the more that we denumb and the more that we inhabit the traumas and the energies that were dissociated, then we're reclaiming power and we're reclaiming energy that we talked about filling up the vantages, then you get access to higher and higher vantages. So really doing healing work is a tremendous spiritual practice. Does that make sense, guys? Well, first I want to say I've been working with Ivana for 10 years. They both do network spinal analysis and trainment, and this has been incredible for my nervous system. I'm a huge advocate for that for people. You really should go check them out. Otherwise, EFT tapping, EMDR, are really good for desensitizing specific events that you have a memory of. And I would say things like somatic experiencing, I would also say that's where psychedelics too can kind of uncover unconscious trauma in the body. So somatic experiencing or psychedelics for things that we don't necessarily know about. But if it's like I've basically gone through, you know, the 50 traumatic plus events of my life, like I got my name on the board in first grade, and I got in trouble when I was three, and like, all of these desensitize it so there's no more charge. So I think about the event, no problem. So that, you know, this might seem overwhelming, but you just start like one a week. Just work with somebody, like desensitize one traumatic event a week to where the charge, you think about, okay, let's a 9 when I think about that. And you get each aspect and now it's a 0. And then that stays a week later, a month later, a year later. I think about that event and there's nothing in my body but openness. So EFT tapping or EMDR for event specific stuff, somatic experiencing or like specific psychedelic, I'm gonna say that with an asterisk, for deeper things in the body.
Yeah, and I also think find a practitioner who can really see you, who can understand your vantage point. Because I've worked with many practitioners who just couldn't meet me where I was, and in the healing, I can only get to a certain point. Yeah. So make sure you find someone who really is able to take you to the place that you need to go and do it in a safe way, in a stable way. No, it's great. It's great. And it's just going to operate at the level of mind. And the research says that talk therapy typically takes longer.
The great book, Healing Developmental Trauma. Marona turned me on to that. That talks about that. And that's filling it up with the missed developmental need experiences. Yeah. So that the nervous system gets the, like, all of a sudden can embody that way of being.
Someone over here had a question. Yeah.
What do you do if, for example, I'm pretty sure I have traumatic experiences, but I can't recall any, and I've always struggled to recall traumatic experiences. I'm sure, I mean, I can't go on as far as that. Would you recommend that?
Me personally, I've found that when people do this, there's two things. There's the possibility for an endless digging to find the problem. And man, what a mess that is. Because if this is your level of development, you're digging, you're spending all this energy to come down here and try to figure out what it is, and you never grow. What I often like doing is doing the work, getting on the cushion, doing whatever your subtle energy practices are, and fill the cup until it becomes readily apparent that there's something going on, and then it's gonna show up. And usually by the time you resource yourself in that way, it doesn't hit you like a bus out of nowhere. It's going to show up in a way that you can, it's going to be often intense, but you can handle it. And also, do healing work. Work with someone who can help you kind of parse out some of the nuances that you can't see in yourself. So I would say do both of those things at the same time. And good healing work is going to do both. It's going to help build you, and it's going to help you uncover. But the tendency of some people to just dig for the problem is, it's a big waste of time in my perspective.
Yeah, to that point, if you're not aware, like, I would just say do Qigong or yoga. Because I just want to say again, like, we're talking about hacking and there's this strategy into it, but like, there's this beautiful, like, intelligence of the universe, and then, like, what Matt said, like, we enter the next phase, and then life gives us this to learn. Or, like, okay, now we've done, like, in my own healing experience, like, it would go in waves. Like, I'd do some pieces, and then, like, life's good for a little bit, And all of a sudden, I'm aware of another piece, and so I work this a little bit. And so, there's this, as I look back, there was this beautiful journey to it.
I would say any psyche that is inherently unstable, psychedelics probably not the first tool that's a go-to. If you feel like you're a pretty stable human, the research says they look at safety of psychedelics on a scale that they call the LD50. The LD50 means if you had 20 rats in a cage, what dose would you have to give them for half of the rats to die? And the dose that you have, pretty cruel, I know, for us heart-centered people, like, oh, little rats. But the dose for most psychedelics that you have to give to the rats for that to happen is way beyond anything that anyone would actually take. And for most, I mean, we get into a conversation about natural versus synthetic, but for most, if you're taking a natural at a dose that is going to keep you in some way, shape, or form human, you know, then it seems as though that tends to be a safe thing.
Just check it out if you're doing it 100 times.
Yeah, I met that guy last week with it, who did 100 Aya journeys in the course of the last 4 years, and I was just... Yeah, totally. Yeah, I'll speak to it briefly, and I think Johnny's also got a really great frame, but the thing that I like to look at in the control surrender conversation is that they kind of build on each other. There's moments for control and moments for surrender, moments for control, moments for surrender, and as we climb the levels, we need both. The thing that happens naturally as we climb the states is ego dissolution, and that tends to put us in a more surrendered state until we're called into the moment of needing control, because it's the appropriate call. Now, when control is sought to generate safety from a perceived threat that's illusory, now we have a different conversation. You know, now there's something there to be loved, there's something there to be looked at, there's something to be uncovered, there's something to be come into right relationship with. And there's many kind of avenues in which to do that. The thing that I see often is, if we're in a spiritual conversation, is that people seek to let go of the ego before the ego is actually really full. And when the ego is really full and happy, it seems to get more ready to surrender itself to the next state. So that really embodied and whole ego is the critical step to letting that ego drop away.
That said, also, like, if we add another frame to control and surrender, like if we say directing and controlling, like, first of all, everything's okay, otherwise we're making shadows, right? Like, there's a time and a place for control. But let's say that we have directing the moment and like trying to control the moment. And then here we have like surrendering is flow. And here we have like unconscious chaos. So let's say that like every quality exists on a spectrum, and these are just like kind of the less resource or less, ways, the unconscious chaos or the like controlling. Because then like there's a virtue to kind of like masculine direction that we don't want to get rid of and say, oh no, like, you're being controlling. And then also, like, that we're really surrendered flow, we're still aware and engaged. It's not like we're riding a horse and we take the reins off, like, no, you get a concussion. So that's the piece that I would add to that.
We're about 25 after.
Okay.
Yeah, I think maybe.
Let's take one more.
Yeah, one more. Who's got a juicy one? Yeah.
Take us home.
Lots of pressure. I hope it's good.
Yeah. So that if this is a daily practice, you just focus your attention on there and you keep feeling it. Movement practices, and then I would work with somebody if it doesn't like thaw out or enlighten. Because when you're adding to, like, the more, just like we experienced in the group field, like, so the more that people were focusing their attention and raising their subtle energy, then did you notice we got more subtle energy in the room, right? So if you're working with somebody that has a, you know, like a certain capacity for presence or love, and same face, then they can, that added to the place can like raise the energy so it kind of liberates. That's what I would say.
Absolutely, absolutely, yeah. And what I would offer is, as you're holding your awareness in that space, let the mind drop any need for something to happen. Let the mind drop any better than. Let all those frames of whatever that need is for it to go away, for it to be fixed, let all that relax. And then also just in a kind of broad, you know, if you talk to God, if you talk to the universe, whatever it is, just invite whatever must be seen, whatever must be felt, whatever must come into consciousness for the highest of you, those that you love, and all of humanity. Usually has a little bit of a, make something show up.
Okay, so I'll give you a free copy if you sign up for the I have an online course, the Presence Academy, where we learn a lot of these skills as well as connection and listening and a ton of really like embodiment practices. So I'll give you a form there and you can get a free copy of the book. I just released it on Saturday. I'm super excited. Thank you. Thank you. A year and a half in the, 2.5 years in the birthing and writing of that. So. No, thank you.
And it's chock full of badassery and wisdom and amazingness. So my recommendation is that you devour it multiple times. We love you.
Also, I just want to say, like, we're doing, if you know Andrew DiGregorio, we're doing a series called Avatar Training, which is this stuff, but a lot of other connection and embodiment stuff. So there'll be a flyer for that. It's free intro tomorrow night. And
I'll just say, for me, if there's something that I said that sparks your interest, the work that I do, you talk to someone else. We've got a couple of plants in the crowd who are our clients in the office. I'd be happy to have a conversation. Just come up, and you know, we'll figure out if I'm the right guy to work with you. So, all that aside, we love you guys. You nailed it. What an amazing experience. Thank you for sharing this time, space, dimension with us. Thank you for offering your attention and your presence and your commitment to your process and just being with us in our sharing of some of the stuff that we've learned that may be useful for you. It's an honor for me. I know it's an honor for Johnny to be just at this momentary kind of mouthpiece of this information, and we love you and thank you so much. I'll be here for a little while if there's a deeper question, and I think Johnny will be here for at least a couple minutes. Yeah. Spread this information out in the world. Like this is the kind of stuff that literally changes lives. Mm-hmm. And if you need resources in which to spread that, books and such, you know, let's have the conversation. I'm happy to share that, and let's keep this wave of goodness rolling.